Welcome friends, welcome into the Veda Scheme Academy. So in last lecture we are talking about the homogeneous catalysis, such as we explained two processes. First one is the hydro formulation process and next one is nothing but the Wacker catalyst. So in both process we got aldehyde as a product. Okay, so now in this lecture we are talking about the solvents. Okay, so you know the solvent. So solvent is nothing but which dissolve the solute molecule, so that is called as the solvent. So water is nothing but the universal solvent, because the water possess such type of properties or able to dissolve so many types of solutes into it. So that's why the water is said to be the universal solvent. Along with that water, some other solvents are recently used. They are called as the non-aqueous solvents. Example is nothing but said to be the NH3 or the liquid said to be H2S or CO2. Okay, so these are nothing but said to be the solvents. They are called as the non-aqueous solvents and rarely used to do the organic as well as the inorganic reaction. They are also said to be the ionic liquids. Now, whenever we talk about the solvents, so we have to came towards what the properties of solvents. Okay, so whenever we are going to choose the solvents for particular reaction, so we focus over some properties of solvent. So how to choose the solvent for particular reaction? So these are nothing but said to be the main points. So the first one is nothing but the melting and boiling point. So this is nothing but the main important concept regarding the solvent. So whenever we choose any solvent for particular reaction, so we think about their temperature range. Okay, so as we know that the water is nothing but said to be the large temperature range is nothing but said to be the 0 to 100. So below 0 the water will going to freeze, okay, and above 100 will water will going to vaporize. So we got a large range where we use this water as a solvent. So that's why the water is nothing but said to be the universal solvent. Why? Because they provide us the big temperature range as the 0 to 100. But when we talk about the other solvents, such as the non-aqueous solvents, so their range is nothing but very limited. So we have to use that that solvent in very low temperature, so that they make some difficulty in their uses. So that's why rarely we are using water as a solvent in so many reactions. So the second property of solvent is nothing but the dipole moment. So you know that the dipole moment is related with the charge in between the molecule, such as suppose if you talk about the benzene or the CCl4. So such type of molecules, they don't have a dipole moment, because the atoms present in that solvent, they have same electronegativity, and that's why they do not possess the dipole moment. But when we talk about the water, so in case of the H2O, the electronegativity of hydrogen and oxygen is nothing but said to be much differ. That's why they contain the dipole moment, and dipole moment is responsible for the solubility of solute into that particular solvent. Means if the solvent possess high dipole moment, so they can easily soluble any solute. Okay, so hence whenever we choose the solvent for particular reaction, so their dipole moment must be higher. Okay, so this is all about the dipole moment. Then third, we are talking about the dielectric constant. So what do you mean by the dielectric constant? So it is related with the electric field. Okay, so how it is related with the electric field? So whenever we have to theoretically, or you can say that the practically, we want to calculate the dielectric constant. So we have to put that particular the object, okay, in electric field. So they will going to rotate itself to neutralize the field. Okay, and that's why we are going to calculate their dielectric constant. So this dielectric constant is obviously related with the dipole moment. So those solvents, they have the higher value of the dipole moment, so they also have the higher value of the dielectric constant. Okay, and that's why it is good for it is good choice as a solvent, or we can easily use in particular said to be the reaction. Then third is nothing but said to be the Lewis acid base character. So you know that about the Lewis concept. So the Lewis concept is nothing but the substances are divided into the two classes. The first one is nothing but the Lewis acid okay, who can able to accept the lone pair, okay, and Lewis base is nothing but said to be the substance which donate, able to donate the lone pair. So this is nothing but said to be the Lewis acid and Lewis base. So whenever we are going to choose a solvent, so some solvents they can be used like a Lewis acid as well as the Lewis base, and that concept is called as the solvation. Okay, means suppose say the NaOH will going to dissolve in water, so after the ionization of the NaOH we got the Na positive and OH negative, okay, and the positive pole of the solvent, that is nothing but the H2O, means the hydrogen ions or the hydrogens which are present in the H2O, they will going to form a circle over say around the OH negative. As the OH is the OH negative and hydrogens are positive, so they form a weak bond in between said to be the OH and hydrogens. They are said to be the positively charged due to the inductive effect. Then next is nothing but Na positive. So the Na positive can be surrounded by means of say the oxygen, because the oxygen is say they have the lone pair, and that's why there is an interaction in between say the lone pair and say the positive charge of the sodium. So in this way, these two species, that is what the Na positive and OH negative, can be surrounded by means of the solvent, and that process is called as the solvation. Okay, so here we use some such solvents, they have tendency to form such bond. Sometimes they may be called as the weak interaction, sometimes they may be called as say the coordinate bond. Okay, so suppose if we use such type of solvent, so they are responsible for the you can say that the solvation, and that solvation make mark effect on the stability of that particular ions which are formed after the ionization. Okay, so this is all about what say the properties of solvent. So now we move towards what say the another concept, that is nothing but the protonic acidity or basicity. Okay, so in that here we saw say the different types of the solvent. So the first one is nothing but the acidic or protogenic solvent. So first we try to understand what do you mean by this acidic and protogenic solvent. So the acidic means what, those substances who are able to provide say the H positive, that is called as the acidic or say the protogenic. So the protogenic is nothing but the similar word used for say the acidic. Okay, so the meaning of the acidic and protogenic are same. So protogenic means what, those who provide the proton, so that will be called as the protogenic. Okay, so here the examples are nothing but say the HCl, then H2SO4, then HNO3. So these are nothing but said to be the protogenic or the acidic solvents, because they are always ready to provide what the H positive ions. Okay, the next is nothing but the basic or protophilic. So here the meaning of the protophilic is nothing but you can say that they will going to absorb this. Okay, they will going to absorb this. So the basic, you know that the basic means they will going to absorb the proton. So here the meaning of the acidic is the donation of proton, and basic is nothing but the acceptance of the proton. Okay, so here the examples are nothing but the NH3. So we know that the NH3 nitrogen is having the lone pair, they will readily absorb the proton and convert into the NH4 positive. Similarly, said to be we already show over here what say this already protonated form of this pH, or say the aniline, or the amines also, they are capable to accept the proton. So these all are nothing but the examples of the basic or the protophilic solvents. The next is nothing but the amphoteric or the amphoproteic solvents. Okay, so you know that what do you mean by the amphoteric nature. Those solvents who can act as a said to be the acid as well as the base, they are called as the amphoteric or the amphoprotic solvents, means they have tendency to donate the proton as well as what they accept the proton. So that's why they are called as what, say the amphoteric or the amphoprotic solvents. So these are nothing but said to be the three types of solvents. Mainly they are called as the protonic acidity or the basicity. So now we move towards the next slide. So this slide will contain what, the non-protonic solvent. Okay, non-protonic. So here the meaning of the non-protonic means, so they don't possess what, say the proton. Okay, they don't possess the proton. So here the first example is nothing but said to be the non-polar, non-dissociated liquids. Okay, so first we try to understand what do you mean by non-polar. Non-polar means what, they have the zero dipole moment. Okay, I already told you what the example is, the CCl4. So in CCl4, so we don't have say the such type of proton. okay, such type of proton. So that's why the solvent is non-polar and it is non-dissociated. So what do you mean by dissociation? So suppose if we take what DH2O, so it will give what DH positive plus OH negative. So this is nothing but said to be the dissociation. But if you suppose consider an example of the CCl4, so that CCl4 will not undergo the dissociation. So that's why it is said to be non-polar and non-dissociated liquids. The example is what? CCl4, carbon tetrachloride. Now, we talk about say the polar but non-dissociated liquid. So what is polar? So polar is what? So they have atoms and there is electronegativity difference in between them. The example is what is CH3CN. So it is acetonitrile. Okay, so in case of the acetonitrile, so we have the electronegativity difference, and that electronegativity difference make the creation of the polarity in between them. So that's why these all solvents, such as what say the acetonitrile, then THF and then DMF. Okay, so all these solvents, they are polar in nature because they possess such type of elements where there is an electronegative difference and make them polar. But they are non-dissociated, okay, means they do not show such type of reaction. Say what, say the H2O is equals to what, H positive plus OH negative. So do not show such type of reaction. Okay, why? Because polarity difference is present in them. So they have the polar, okay, but the polarity is not much to dissociate them. So that's why they are said to be the non-dissociated liquids. And lastly, so we have the highly polar and self-ionizing liquids. Okay, so what do you mean by this highly polar? So you know that the best example is the H2O. So which is what, the highly polar. Okay, so there is a large electronegativity difference in between the hydrogen and oxygen. So that's why that difference make them highly polar. Okay, and they are also said to be the self-ionizing liquids because they undergo self-ionization. I mean, suppose if you take what say the H2O plus H2O, so one H2 will act as a acid and another will act as a base. So the you got what say the H3O positive plus OH negative. So this is nothing but said to be the self-ionization. Or SO2 is nothing but there. SO2 will be converted into SO negative and SO3 positive. So this is nothing but said to be the self-ionizing liquids. And finally, so we have the auto-dissociation of the solvent. Auto means what? The itself they undergo what said the solvent. It means the H2O will undergo H positive plus OH negative, and NH3 will undergo what's the H positive plus NH2 negative. So